Cursed by the old gods in Bethany, we are four immortals hiding among the stars, trying to break our curse of completing the 1001 pieces of pop culture before we are captured by impossibly powerful beings. This is a review show. And it's episode 103.
Woohoo!
Ooh, that's awesome.
Look at that. Look at us.
We're good.
Who are we?
What?
I am Austin.
That's a weird way to start.
Nailed it.
Call that one as weird. Mm-hmm. I'm Sarah, though.
I'm Lee.
And I'm Pedro.
And together we are the Immortals.
That we are.
Here we are, just doing what we do, hiding on a planet we're not going to name, as we just kind of do what's going on.
Yeah.
Pedro, did you build me anything useful to get around with my...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I built you some wooden legs.
God damn it.
But I told you to build him, like, cool Darth Maul spider legs.
Those take a little longer. Now you got, like, squeaky wooden legs.
I have so many splinters in my, like, upper thigh. Mm-hmm. It is less than great.
And you have to use a cane, but...
Which you haven't built yet.
Gets you around. No, but you can just find a stick anywhere.
Yeah. Anyway, for those of you who are confused, I don't know, 20 episodes ago, cockroach monster ate my legs.
Sure.
This is a review show.
Yeah.
And every week we review one of the 1001 movies, albums, food, songs, and TV shows that you must consume before you die. And this week we're doing the 513th entries of all of those books that have been published. You okay, Lee?
Yeah, I'm just throwing shit.
just for funsies?
She realized what we're doing. Like, this fucking show again.
Yeah, I'm out of it.
It's okay. By the way, the 513th entries of all these things, the movie is Gimme Shelter.
The album is Number of the Beast by Iron Maiden.
Food is Ptarmigan.
The song is Boys Don't Cry by The Cure.
And the TV show is Sliders. But first, Gimme Shelter.
It's creating a sort of microcosmic society, you know, which sets an example to the rest of America as to how one can behave in large gatherings.
Gimme Shelter is a documentary made in 1970 by the Maisels brothers and Charlotte Zerwin.
And who?
Charlotte Zerwin.
There we go.
They are best known for their work on films like Grey Gardens and Salesman, but this is considered to be one of the greatest movies about rock and roll ever made. It follows the Rolling Stones on their 1969 tour, especially with the free concert they did at the end, which had an antagonist kind of come into play.
We'll
get to that soon. But first, let's talk about the film in general and also what we think of the beloved term rockumentaries.
Well, I hate the term, but I also dislike the term mockumentary. They're just all dumb. Mockumentary, at least, has a purpose of making clear that it is not a documentary, right? It is a different thing than a documentary. A rockumentary is a stupid term because it's a documentary. That's just what it is.
A documentary that rocks.
But it didn't this time.
It's a little depressing.
I didn't really like this movie.
You didn't like this one.
Okay, so I didn't have any historical context for the show. Okay. So the grand finale part, I didn't know it was coming. So that was actually kind of fun to watch it unfold. But that's like, apart from that, you just watch the band sit there and listen to their own music. Of which, I'm not a huge fan of Rolling Stones music. I mean, it's all
I have a lot of opinions about the Rolling Stones.
I figured you probably did. In fact, while we were watching this, I was like, I wonder what Lee's opinions on the Rolling Stones are.
I have a lot of opinions.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, the movie was mostly just boring. And like, half of it was a different show completely. They would just cut to them playing in Madison Square Garden. It was a lot more interesting watching Tina Turner get up there and sing.
She was so good.
Right?
So, I'm going to comment a little bit about the Maisels. Because like I mentioned, their most famous films are Grey Gardens and Salesman. And while they actually are... One of them is seen on camera during this movie. What to me makes them one of the greatest documentary filmmakers of all time is just the way they are like fly on the wall plus. Someone like Frederick Weissman, his movies like the one he did about Berkeley is so fly on the wall that it is almost unbearable to watch because his movie sometimes is 6 hours long. Yeah. You'll watch a budget meeting in its entirety and then you'll watch follow-up budget meetings by similar boards. It becomes a fascinating experience as subjects, but it's not cinematic all the time. I think we have one or two to cover on the list. But the Maisels, to me, it's fly on the wall, but the fly is so kind of close to your face, and they make an environment where the subjects kind of forget they're there. So I actually like how their films get boring in a way, because like, to me, there's a cool contrast between here they are on stage, he's wearing a cape, he's, you know, he's thrusting, and then like
that is what he does.
What they have to do the rest of the day, which is discuss the venue size and make sure that the audio levels are good for their songs. Like it's the night and day of being a rock star. And I kind of liked, especially since it's only 90 minutes and they are a pretty fun group to watch, the boring aspect really kind of worked. And when they show the concerts, this is just like having a camera in the back of the arena.
Yeah, they're really well shot.
It's blended and edited in a way of like, it captures what it would like to be there, not like literally what happened. So I like them as filmmakers, but they are, I guess, would be pushing the line if those scenes didn't work of their... Oh, since their manager as the main focus. Or if you don't like their music, which is why I now want to transition to Lee, because Lee has now hinted opinions.
So, okay. Here's the thing. Anyone out there who is wanting to have a career in music and be that big time rock and roll star or pop star just needs to look at Mick Jagger for inspiration, because he can't sing. He can't dance, and he's not attractive.
He's not hot, yeah.
Not attractive at all, and yet here he is, one of the biggest and most recognized rock stars in the entire world, still today. Second, the Rolling Stones have a very specific sound. Unfortunately, they stole it from black people.
This is true.
Like, they just took blues songs, they took classic blues that eventually evolved into rock and roll sounds, and just took it. And it's wonderfully repackaged as these English white boys. So it's okay for suburban housewives and teenagers in the 1960s and 70s to listen to them, because they're not offensive, because they're not black.
Right. Even though they are, like, doing lots of thrusting.
But they're white and they're British, so they're not harmful.
Right.
They're not going to rape their lovely daughters in the middle of the night, although they probably would.
Yes.
I don't want to talk next.
No, I mean, I think I like the Rolling Stones music. I'm not going to, like, discount their place in rock history. Like, they have a million imitators. They have a lot of great songs, but yeah, no, I mean, they're super fucking problematic. Although, what you say about stealing music from black people is true about pretty much every rock and roll band.
Oh, no, there is no rock and roll band who can get away scot-free here.
Yeah,
they're all guilty.
Well, we've acknowledged, I mean, it's 103 now, and I think unanimously the greatest musician we've covered is Marty McFly. And the way he did Johnny B. Goode at the Enchantment of the Sea Dance was revolutionary to rock history.
Yeah.
He did not. It's a fake movie.
I don't understand. Something that made me really curious about Mick Jagger, as like we're watching him in his prime, I did ask Sarah watching, like, is he attractive at all? Because he has that like traditional Englishman, like, weird face sometimes. Like,
yeah, no.
Like, bones are all over the place in a way that is fine. But like, he's thrusting his junk to the audience, and no one is upset about this.
No.
In fact, there are
girls who want to be very close to his junk.
Yes. And many topless women, a la every audience of Spartacus, whatever the crowd scenes during Spartacus, that's how you show approval, is to take off your shirt. But what I found something interesting by him was a small scene, because it happens throughout the film, where you see him do spontaneous and probably not sober interviews outside of his trailer. And he's kind of talks and says rambling stuff, and it's fine, because he is like this like mysterious legendary rock star. And the way he like talked about this free concert, saying, "You're supposed to have good times, just kind of want to show the music and kind of have the vibe and kind of like, we're all going to get high, we're all going to, you know, find love and make love, it's going to be great. Okay, no more questions." It kind of goes back inside. I just like watch that and go, that's like verbatim what Miley Cyrus says all the time. And we hate her. Like,
yeah, it's really true.
She just kind of says similarly dumb things about how, like, it's about the music. You know, if you're attracted, it's great. And, you know, just get some drugs, it's gonna be cool. We're all like, how dare you? How dare you, Miley Cyrus? You are a disgusting example towards children. And yes, Rolling Stones always had, like, you know, parents groups hate them. But those shots of how big this free concert is, it looks like it goes for miles.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I mean, it was trying to recreate Woodstock, to say point blank, with, I believe, one of the guys who helped create Woodstock, got the afro.
And it's documenting a thing that we don't really do anymore. I mean, I was looking, I've never seen a crowd like that for a concert. Mm-hmm. And the reason is because now we do things in more sort of safe, sanitized ways.
Mm-hmm.
For reasons, which are good reasons, but, you know, Lollapalooza feels very different than what we see in this movie, even though I would imagine the crowd sizes are probably about the same, and, you know, there's lots of people taking drugs at Lolla, but it's a very different, much more structured, much mm-hmm. more corporate, and it's just a different thing.
You describing that made me think, like, what is the most sanitized corporate version of this? I think it's when, was it 2-3 years ago, when that new U2 album went on everyone's phones, no matter what?
Oh, yeah.
That is the same kind of crowd size for this. Except no one knew they were attending.
Oh.
But as we talk now about the show, we need to talk about the... Not a lot of documentaries have antagonists. Yes, we covered Billy Mitchell and the King of Kong, yes. But...
One of the greatest antagonists ever.
This has an appearance by the Hells Angels. I say appearance, I mean half the movie devoted to them.
Yep. Yeah.
What did we think about this biker gang who was here to cause some shit and cause some violence? And especially how Mick Jagger's message of peace and love doesn't play out as well when you just, like, say it and it's punctures.
Well, I mean, I find Hells Angels to be a deeply fascinating group historically. I mean, they still exist. Things that they have gotten in the news for recently include blocking off funeral processions for kids who are being protested by Westboro Baptist Church. They're weird, and they've never quite fit into anybody's... They're never what anybody wants them to be. They're not all bad, and they're not all good, and they're not all violent, and they're not all... They also have a role, and they play this role in the movie, of this sort of weird keeping the peace kind of thing, where their presence means that other fights don't break out, or that, you know, there's the scene with a gun, and it's a Hell's Angels guy who gets the gun away from the guy, because that's not... They're not gonna do that. But they obviously... bring with them a fair amount of danger themselves. And I mean, I just have always found them a really fascinating group because they refuse to be labeled. They refuse to fit into anybody's box for them. Like, there's all sorts of, like, weird, cool, random stories about the Hells Angels that mm-hmm. I just... Like, one of the branches of the Hells Angels in one particular city for kids who have been violently attacked, kids who have perpetrators somewhere out in the world and have, like, sort of worries about that perpetrator coming back, they have a program where they'll sit outside a kid's house all night. They'll get to know the kid, and then they'll be like, if anybody comes to fuck with you, I'm outside your house all night. And they'll do it for as long as the kid needs them to. Like, so, like, they're just weird. The Hells Angels are weird and interesting, and they also get in, like, crazy biker fights, you know? Like, so it's... And certainly branches of them have, you know, killed people. So it's an interesting, odd group, and I found them... No one quite knew what to do with them in the movie, I think, and that's what happens when Hell's Angel shows up.
So they just kind of appeared and then volunteered impromptu to just stand there and be security? Like, no one asked them?
Yeah,
they just
kind of
just did
and
that?
And they that's the kind of thing that they do.
But it
didn't work.
No, because they were part of those fights as well.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, they
got they provide a very specific kind of security.
Mm-hmm. And, I mean, one got on stage and started, like, debating with Mick Jagger about this, which was crazy. But what's so odd, I think, why, to me, the movie succeeds so well is that it's not a concert film. You're just getting a collection of Rolling Stones songs. The film shows you and shows them the atmosphere they're creating, whether it's intended or not. Like, it's really cool when the Maisels put themselves in the movie to have them watch the footage, like, see where the gun is. This was all happening.
That part, like, kind of weirded me out, though, because sometimes I'll be like, wait, am I supposed to be watching this as... the band watching their own documentary that's happening now? Because, sometimes it would, like, zoom out, and you'd see them watching the exact same thing we were just watching on a little screen. I was like, wait, so what are...
I thought that was awesome.
I liked that.
It was just... It
well, because it's not...
Made
like,
it not make as much sense.
Well, it's not them going, like, oh, look, you missed a beat there in your song. It's more of like, while you guys have all the lights on you, this is what's
just
actually happening
like
around
that.
You. And this is what we saw that you didn't see while you were doing your job.
Right. And I liked seeing the reactions from the band. Like, I think Mick Jagger's reaction at the end is, like, absolutely the perfect tone for this documentary. Like, he comes out of it, and he's like, okay, yep, that happened, and... You can tell he feels bad about it.
Yeah.
And I appreciated that.
But they also don't close down the concert. You know, it's like, they don't, you know, there's this, he gives a speech from stage about, like, which is a very sort of interesting speech, saying, like, be better than, like, you know, sort of like, don't do this, don't be this way.
Amazingly ineffective.
But no, but it doesn't do anything, right? But, like, if you really, I mean, if you were really worried, and I think it says, it's a really interesting moment of his character, because he is obviously emotionally affected by this. He doesn't just go, like, this is all part of the rock. Like, he clearly is concerned.
This is what's happening,
right, but he doesn't shut down the concert. Like, he could. Yeah. He could just say, like, this isn't safe. We're not doing this anymore.
And that's but
from his perspective, though, you have to think about it, because, like, he knows he has a crowd of 200,000 people who are there for a free concert, and if they suddenly stop the concert, he could have a riot on his hands. So I think he's really put in a difficult position.
Yeah. Well, and again, this is why we don't do this anymore, right? Yeah. Like there's a reason that we have metal detectors at Lollapalooza. Like, you know,
there,
like,
are barricades.
Right.
Well, I mean, also, like, I just enjoyed how petty they seemed as well. Like, before he makes that larger speech, he has a small speech going, guys, whenever we start a song, there's, like, a fight going out. It really kind of, like, hurts the rhythm of, like, we're performing. Like, we just want to, like, do a song. Like,
yeah.
That's not a good answer to have. No.
Although I also, like, I understand, like, but I think Lee's right. Like, there's not, it's unclear what he should do.
Mm-hmm.
Because with, like, this sheer size of the crowd is really, there's a couple of shots that they get that make it clear that the shot of the traffic going in, mm-hmm. like, just make it clear that you have a unmanageable number of people who you do not know, and you do not know why anybody, like, who they are, why they're there, like, what their sort of
mm-hmm.
general intentions are, like,
and they're mostly all fucked up.
Yeah, and they're all high on various substances. And
my favorite
part,
like, was the guy in the crowd who was selling different things, just like, shouting LSD, marijuana, mushrooms. I like that guy.
It was funny.
And it's what I like about the movie is it could have been very judgmental. Like, it lets you draw your own conclusions.
Yeah.
It doesn't, you know, the movie could have easily started with a, you know, a text on black screen of, like, in this year, like, Rolling Stones staged a concert that got out of hand, or, like, was the most dangerous concert. You know, like, they could have done that. And they don't. They let you watch it and let you sort of experience with the band this quiet but scared feeling that things have gotten a little out of hand.
Mm-hmm.
Or very out of hand.
And the Maisels are so good. I was like, I think they clearly like the music, too. Like, they're not just there to go, like, all right, time to say fuck these guys. Like,
they
depict those, like, concert scenes and whatnot. The music sounds great. I mean, I like most of the songs quite a bit. And also the bit with Tina Turner was magnificent.
Well, and I like it because it does very much seem like the documentarians came in without an agenda and
mm-hmm.
found what they found, which is all, I think, are always the best documentaries. I think the same is true of Grey Gardens, the best documentary ever made in the history of documentaries ever, where similarly, I don't feel like they had... Well, in that movie, they really didn't need to look for something interesting because it was all right there. But here, I feel like it seems like they probably went in just figuring at the very least this will be a concert film. And instead, they got to something interesting.
Well, I love that there is a... Because they rarely are kind of on screen like this. There's a brief moment they kind of explain how they work. The guy going like, so you want to put your camera down, like, face me? No, we prefer this way that we can, like, look at you. We might not look at you for much time at all. We'll look what we find interesting.
Mm.
And that's kind of their philosophy. Like, they're always able to find what's interesting. And really, really fascinating. I love watching their stuff. And this was cool. Like, it's a very different kind of movie. And you now understand Spinal Tap some more.
Heavily
influenced by Spinal Tap.
Well, Spinal Tap was heavily influenced by this.
Yes. Because that is definitely one that has, like, the concert that also has, like, dealing with the aftermath of various drummers who die. And
well, they all,
those poor drummers.
Yeah.
But, Peter, you're still shaking your head. You want to hear more of your...
Okay, so all of that stuff was interesting. I still didn't like how I had to sit through, like, 45 minutes of just basically watching them perform at a different show and just sit around and do nothing. It could have been either shorter or more of the, this is how a concert like this is set up. That was really cool, seeing them in the room talking with people. It's like, all right, well, we have a venue here. What are we going to do about cars? That sort of thing. That was fun. Seeing them fly over the highway and seeing all the cars just parked on the side of the highway. Because yeah. Where else are you going to put 200,000 cars or however many?
Apparently 300,000 people were there.
Yeah.
That is not a reasonable number of people. That's what I'm saying. Like, only, the number of people there, that is unreasonable.
And only a few dozen Hell's Angels.
Yep.
Jesus. I always like in older documentaries being like, that person is old now. Mm-hmm. You know, like Mick Jagger's 74. Yep. And there's a baby in there at the last time. Which, first of all, who brings a baby to this?
No, well, there was a baby born.
Yeah.
Well, yes, but like, but I was looking at that baby and I'm like, oh, that baby is actually a reasonable age right now. That baby is probably like 40. Mm-hmm.
I hope this film and also the Woodstock documentary inspired like personal like investigators for like who their dad is.
Yeah.
As we wrap up, is there any particular song you enjoyed that was being performed?
I like Tina Turner's bit.
Yeah, Tina Turner's
thing was really cool.
I like Satisfaction.
I mean, I always like Satisfaction. It's a great song.
Like Lee said, they're not... I even said this at the beginning of him. I'm like, they don't sound good. He doesn't sing well. I prefer their studio edits because they fix
things. It's true. That's true. Them in concert is not like... It's not one of those bands that you're like, wow, like, they're so much better in concert. Like, no. No.
Gimme Shelter. Let's give some hinges to it. I give it a 4.2.
I liked it. I didn't, like... completely love it. I'll give it a 3.8.
I'll give it a 3.7.
3.75.
Alright, that is Gimme Shelter by the Maisels and Charlotte Zewin. You can find this currently on Filmstruck in many other places.
Oh, damn it. I rented it.
It's not a big planet we're on. You could have shouted from over there saying, hey, how are you all watching this?
You guys watch it.
Yeah.
Nah.
Anywho. Now it's time for a band that is definitely more low-key, and definitely has never caused any sort of violent outbreaks whatsoever.
Yep, Lee, they're really subtle.
What did we listen to?
We listened to The Number of the Beast by Iron Maiden. This is their third studio album that came out in March of 1982. It's their first album with their second kind of featured vocalist, Bruce Dickinson. And his inclusion, his addition to this album, I think really helped Iron Maiden become what they're known for today.
I had never heard a full Iron Maiden album, and I'm going to say... as a complete surprise to me, this is like my favorite album we've heard in like so many episodes.
I have to agree. Like, I've heard songs here and there. Like, I've heard the title track off of the album, The Number of the Beast, and I've heard Run to the Hills, which is the one that probably most people would be familiar with.
Yeah.
Great song. I loved this album. I thought this album was fantastic. It made doing chores this morning so much fun.
There was... because like I recognized Number of the Beast and Run of the Hills, but the one that I just like really really loved because it was a bit more like low key but still as awesome as the rest of the album was 22 Acadia Avenue.
Yeah, that one's a fun one too. I didn't know what to expect going into this because I've only heard like a song here and there by Iron Maiden. Again, like you, I haven't sat down and listened to a whole album of theirs. So the first song starts off loud, heavy, fast, and it's great. Really lots of high energy. And then the second one kind of starts off a little slower. I was like, okay, this will be a nice change of pace, blah, blah, blah. Nope, about 10 seconds in, completely ramps up the energy again. So it's an album that gets to 10 and then goes to 11 and stays there. And I'm totally down for that.
It never felt repetitive or like indulgent in a way because like it creates its world of like, you know, praise Satan, this is the kind of like crazy stuff we're doing, but it's also like Run from the Hills is you're running from the shit that's going on. Like, it is a really great album that gets you amped up, even if you aren't a Satanist or even someone who ever listens to heavy metal like I do.
Also, it's different than other rock albums we've listened to, especially recently, because most of the ones we've listened to recently are, oh, I'm a sad boy. Oh, I'm in love with a sad girl. Oh, we're sad together. Oh, now we're sad apart. That's what we've listened to a lot recently. And that's really boring. this, each song is like its own little fantasy world of like demons and dragons and other shit going on. I don't know, it's crazy, but it's so much fun to listen to, and the lyrics are different, and it's not just, oh, I'm sad, blah, blah, blah. It'll talk about, like, actually being children of the damned, and number 666, and things like that. So, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it a lot more than I expected to.
Yeah, it's really, it's fucking awesome. Like, I did not think that going in. Like, I was ready to be the uncool guy going, that was uncomfortable to listen to. No.
Well, I think that there's just, like, this perception when you get to the terms like heavy metal and hard rock that it's just, it's loud and noisy and there's no real finesse or skill that goes into it. And I think this album completely disproves all of that. Like, Bruce Dickinson's voice and vocals are insane. Like, you can't find another hard rock vocalist that sounds like that. And I think that he brings so much more. Because I went back and I listened to some of their Iron Maiden's music before they replaced their vocalist. And they sounded fine. They were like, they sounded like a generic heavy metal band of the era. You add Bruce Dickinson in and it just goes up that extra level. And it just becomes this new, unique, cool thing to listen to.
It's awesome.
It's super fun.
Pedro, you gonna listen to this one day?
I kind of want to listen to this now.
You gotta listen to it, Pedro. I really do think you'll enjoy it.
Because, like, I'm not calling you out. I just kind of saw you going, like, can we stop recording so I can listen to this?
Oh, it sounds like a lot of fun, and I'm a big fan of hard, heavy rock metal stuff, so, yeah.
Also, yeah, fastest 45 minutes ever.
Perfect. Yeah, put it on the background music if you need to get something done, and you will get that shit done. My dishes got done so quickly this morning.
Especially if you don't want to do the chore.
Yeah.
All right, these are for Hinges. Lee, what do you give it?
I'll give it a 4. It's solid, and it's great, and I recommend it to people.
I'm going to give it a 4.7. This was fantastic. Damn. Yeah, this is like the best album we've heard in I don't know when.
A very long time.
Weirdly loved this. All right, now it's time for the food section. Sarah.
So the food is ptarmigan, which is a kind, starts with P, P-T-A-R-M-I-G-N. It is a kind of game bird akin to quail. I was not able to acquire it. So you know how, like, I have to eat all these foods before I die? I think if we ever get back to Earth, I'm gonna need to just, like, leave y'all for a while and go on, like, a Rambo killing sure. of various wild animals around the world. Because I've missed so many animals that are just wild animals that I'm supposed to hunt and kill with a combat knife. And so I just feel like that's a thing I'll have to do before I can die.
You should probably watch a Rambo film before you do that.
I don't.
Because I think you have a different idea of what Rambo does.
Yeah.
That's fair.
It's not... Yeah.
That's fair. I've never seen a Rambo movie. But unfortunately, I don't have this food. I feel bad about that, but, you know, whatever.
We'll find a way to kill little birds.
Don't cry. We're not going to cry. We're boys.
Yeah.
Pedro, what are we here this week?
Boys don't cry. By the Cure. Cry is a song by The Cure, as I said before.
But is it a song?
It is a song. Came out in 79, I think, with the album of the same name. It's got an interesting music video, which are kids playing with shadows of the adults. It's not an interesting music video. It's kind of boring. The song's kind of meh, to be honest.
Yeah.
It's kind of fun sounding. It's a little jumpy, that sort of thing, but it just doesn't hit anything home.
I really like The Cure, too, but I was like, why this song? There's, like, a lot of other songs by The Cure that are really good.
The lyrics are okay. This guy feels real bad because he was real mean, but he's not going to cry because it's not going to help anything.
And then there's that 30 minutes where they discuss the studio space rental fees.
Yeah.
And, like, that was...
That was awesome.
I got to see what The Cure was like in real life.
Yeah, it's, 3 minutes long. Not very long song. With not a lot in it, to be honest, in my opinion.
I thought it had a cool tune to it.
I like this song. It's a fun little song. I think it has terrible ideas of gender roles and things like that, but I think it's a fun little song.
It's all right.
I was really not wowed by this song. I've heard it before. Like, I know, like, what it is.
It's cute. But, like, it doesn't have a kind of, like, staying power that I'm expecting from this list. I mean, I know I'm shooting for the moon here because of some of the stuff that we've covered.
It didn't convince me not to cry.
Yeah, I like that. I don't know. There's not a lot I can say.
I don't know the Cure that much, but I thought the tune was better than the lyrics and the vocals. So
I'll give you that. That's true. I'm not a fan of that kind of sound. It's got, like, all of three paragraphs on Wikipedia, so they obviously don't care that much, which is definitely the benchmark, right, on how important something is, how long the Wikipedia article is.
Absolutely. For the record, there's other ways to do research, guys. I feel like I should have brought this up 100 episodes ago, but...
No thanks. Yeah, it's okay. It's a mess song.
We have listened to The Cure before.
Yeah, and I like The Cure. That's why I was bummed.
What did we listen to?
Listened to the album Pornography on episode 19.
That was a long time ago. And also, that was when we were on Earth. So I keep like listening to it throughout the day. And that album cover was not as easy to like turn on.
No.
When you're on the train.
Yeah.
Like, what did you listen to? Okay.
Pornography.
Straight up Pornography.
Alrighty.
It's a fine song. It just goes back to what I was complaining about less than 5 minutes ago. It's whiny boys crying about being sad.
Yep.
Yeah.
Is this our most low-key episode, which is all about rock and roll, basically?
Pretty much, yeah.
Yep. Or some wild and crazy guys.
Did we do Just Like Heaven?
Maybe.
The Reese Witherspoon Mark Ruffalo movie?
Yeah, and a number podcast 76.
Ah.
We did that song.
Yes.
Which I think I had similar opinions.
I like Just
Like Heaven. Mark Ruffalo's in that many like romantic comedies. Like,
we're talking about a different Just Like Heaven, honey.
He had a run of like, I'm a really credible indie actor.
Also, total tangent, but that movie is a chick flick that then takes a super political turn and is a strange movie.
He's just like, because they had that in 13 Going on 30 where he's just like, he's a romantic interest who's kind of bewildered what's even happening to this woman. Like, I'm sorry, are you dead? Are you a teenager? I don't know why I'm supposed to be in love with you right now.
No, but she's not dead. She's in a permanent coma. But how terrible would it be if you had decided to not continue her life because there was no brain activity and killed her because she obviously is still a soul? I hate that movie.
Well, how does she get out of the coma?
I don't know.
She wakes up.
Yeah.
Oh. Fuck me then. I thought maybe the answer was turning it off. They go, okay.
No, the power of love, maybe. No, yeah, the power of love. So clearly we should all just wait until Mark Ruffalo shows up.
Yeah. That's how The Big Sick ended, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right, we're on a hinges. Yes. High tangent.
I don't know, 3.5.
Boys don't cry.
3.5 hinges.
Three.
Three's fine.
I disliked it more than you guys, and I gave it a higher rating.
Yeah, but your 3.5 is like a 1.7 to us.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Like a 1.3.
It's all objective. TV show. Fucking it, Sliders. You travel to parallel worlds. The same year, the same Earth, only different dimensions. A world where the Russians rule America. Or where your dreams of being superstar came true. Or where San Francisco was a maximum security prison. My friends and I found the gateway. Now the problem is finding a way back home. As I've said now for at least 80 of the 103 episodes, why is this show on the list?
It's a television show.
It's because there aren't 1,001 good shows. I'm not saying great shows. I mean good shows. And Sliders proves that. Sliders is a sci-fi show that started in 1995, starring the actor of our generation, Jerry O'Connell. He's a genius kid who invents a machine that makes you go to parallel worlds. So he and his girlfriend, or not girlfriend, just girl, who's Natalie from Sports Night. Hmm. And John Rhys-Davies, who's his professor, in full John Rhys-Davies-ness.
Mm-hmm.
Wears tweed the whole goddamn series. And a super annoying lounge singer who is driving nearby all get sucked into a vortex where they go to a parallel world. Because of some bad CGI effect of, like, them all about to die, they used the timer to get back incorrectly, and now they are bouncing from parallel world trying to get back home. So the premise of the show is that every week they're in a different kind of parallel world where, like, oh, this one has San Francisco is like a prison city.
It's like Stargate.
Yeah. But like more quantum leapish, where they can't get back home and they don't have control and shit. Yeah, it's bad. It's really bad in a particular kind of like 90s sci-fi bad, where like people can now make cheap TV shows to get all the sci-fi nerds writing their idea of what they want to talk about, like real sci-fi, which means none of the characters act like characters or people in the slightest. It's just horribly written all the time. And even the sci-fi aspects are really bad. Like, it's just to the point where I saw season one and most season two and read the hilarious Wikipedia article about what happens next. Seriously, if you guys want a fun deep dive, just read what the fuck happened in later seasons of Sliders. It's insane. I'll get to it in a second. But it's just not even very creative. Like, oh, this is the world where there's like a bad disease. Now we've got to do this. Or, this one doesn't have the Bill of Rights and such. So they just kind of typically preach about all the stuff from their parallel world. And it just starts to feel...
Earth, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it starts to feel like colonialism, where like their version of reality is the only right one. And they kind of are always lecturing them about how to like treat people and run their society when like they should all be like parallel. Whatever. It's pretty dumb. The best episode was still pretty bad, was a episode that is very mysteriously never been on Netflix or Hulu, the only one of the series, where it is a matriarchy, so a patriarchy.
Interesting.
And just women have run everything for the entire time, and...
Is it way better?
Yeah, it seems like it, but the show still didn't fully embrace the idea, because the female character still isn't the main character of this episode.
No.
So it's mostly Jerry O'Connell and John Rhys Davies complaining about how, like, it's not fair for men! And the show recognizes their double standards, that's the fun of it, right. But still, like, you should have Sabrina Lloyd finally have an episode to herself. But it had some, like, really good satire, because, like, John Rhys Davies runs for mayor, so he can get more rights to men. He's, like, the first guy to run for mayor.
Sorry, that's actually kind of hilarious.
It's crazy. Like, he's the first guy to run for, like, any political figure, like, ever, basically. And I just loved the debate they had, because this is, like, 1995 when they had this joke where, like, the current mayor who's running again, she says, listen, I'm all for, you know, men in the workplace. I am married to my husband. I have two sons. It was just kind of like,
That's great.
I love that a lot. And every once in a while, the show has some small, clever ideas, but every episode still is an embarrassment of truly horrible writing. And then last episode I saw, I jumped ahead to see this show, as my friend described, just kind of really jump the shark in a really crazy way, because then they're gonna start fighting aliens who also have sliding abilities.
Good.
And then shit just gets really crazy. So I watched the first one where this plot appears. I think maybe this would be the most coherent way to get the audience into essentially a whole new series. And nope, it was incomprehensible as fuck. As most of the episodes are, Sliders is a bad show. Ran for 5 seasons. Fox, you know, famously put it all out of order. Canceled it. Sci-fi picked it up. Yeah.
Sala. I was like...
That is John Rhys Davies. Yeah. Yes. Forgot to translate for Pedro.
I was like, I know that name. It's important for me for some reason.
Yeah.
It's Sala.
So yeah, it's a gibberish bad show.
Cool.
But Sala, though.
Like, how many henges worth of bad?
1.5.
Wow. It's not a lot of henges.
No, it's not. It's bad. I mean, I'll still finish it. Because
you're broken.
Truly, everyone read this Wikipedia article about what happens between seasons 3 through 5 and try not to be curious about how any of this happens.
Okay.
It's a bonkers bad show.
Cool.
Sliders. Check it out. Currently on Hulu.
All right.
That's just 103.
Woo.
Got a shorter episode today. I mean, it's okay.
Do you guys know 103 is a prime number?
Did you know it took you the whole episode to look it up?
Yeah, but I was also looking up.
I was pretty sure it was prime, but I didn't want to say it at the beginning in case I was wrong. Like, I was doing the math. What does that mean?
It's a prime number and it's a happy number.
What does that mean?
Happy numbers are where you take the number and you add up the square of each digit. So 1 squared + 0 squared + 3 squared.
Uh-huh.
And you get a new number and you do the same thing and you keep going until it either hits 1 or an infinite loop that doesn't have 1. If it ends at 1, it's a happy number.
This sounds like a very, very, very dumb game that doesn't really mean anything about numbers.
I like to imagine that scientists have never anything on their to-do list, like, fuck, we gotta figure out how to, like, fix cancer, and all this kind of, like, guys, I did this fun thing. It's called happy numbers.
Yeah,
like,
basically.
They have finished their to-do list because they started, like, I think way earlier than most scientists, you know, thousands of years.
No, yeah.
So they're, for a while. Like, I think you guys finished math and are now, like, doing fun stuff.
We haven't, but that's okay.
But we need a number for next time. Pedro, use your little gizmo thing.
Cool. That's me pushing a button.
Sure.
975.
Cool.
Okay, that's a more recent one.
Yeah. I like those.
Oh, the movie is Inception.
Run!
Huh. I haven't seen it.
You've never seen Inception?
Wow.
No.
Oh, that's fun. It's good. It's exciting. You should watch it.
I bet you will within the next week.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of long, so be prepared.
There's also an ad absurdum about it, which is the current ad absurdum that's up.
So listen to that afterwards.
Yeah, expect a new ad absurdum in the new year.
Awesome. The song is Flux by Block Party.
How is that spelled?
F-L-U-X.
Like the flux capacitor?
Like the flux capacitor.
Like our favorite musician, Marty McFly.
Yes.
Go away.
Inventor of
the album is The Sound of Silver by LCD Sound System.
The food is Lekvar.
You know what that is?
Yeah, it's a prune spread. Should be able to...
Wow, can't wait for that one.
All right.
That one was a real sell.
Well, I think Amazon only sells this in packs of three, so...
Stop ordering from Amazon. We're on the run. And the TV show is The 100, which is currently on CW right now, and can be found on Netflix.
Cool.
I am skeptical because of my current watching of a sci-fi show.
But hey, it's on CW, so it might be a beautiful mess like Riverdale.
Which is not on our list.
Because the list came out before.
I know.
Yeah.
Riverdale.
So good!
See us next bonus episode. I'm sure she'll pick Riverdale.
That's not going to happen.
All right, well, you can come back next week, where we are going to have our first episode in the new year next week.
Yeah.
Thank you all for listening in 2017. Yeah. We hope you all had a happy holidays all around. Some New Year's coming up. And if you're bored trying to avoid family, you can always check out the artimmortal.com. Leave your thoughts on Gimme Shelter, I think we reviewed today. Or you can check out the other podcasts, like Let's Take Five. Yesterday, Eric and I recorded and released our bonus episode about Orson Welles. I think... Listen to the episode to be sure. We're going to take tomorrow off, so we'll come back in the new year with our new five, which will be the French auteur Jean-Pierre Melville.
Cool.
Which is going to be really awesome because he made a great film that Pedro and I love, Les Samurai.
Hey, yeah. Les Samurai.
Les Samurai. And yeah, Adam Sardom, as I said, is about Inception. So listen to that after our episode next week. And
expect me to do that a lot next week.
That's... Our editor is going to quit. speaking of, always thank Rook for editing, Adam for the music, and follow us on Twitter at The Immortals Pod, where Lee does awesome tweets. And also, we should have mentioned it last week, but we didn't. Go to theartimmortal.com for Lee's commentary track. Lee, you want to pitch what this is?
So every year, my brother and I, along with the rest of our family, sit down and watch the classic Christmas film, White Christmas, all day on Christmas Eve.
All day?
So, all day. Like, we start it at, like, 10 a.m. and end it at, like, 7 p.m. We watch it all day on repeat. And so my brother and I decided to record a commentary track for you guys. We have lots of years of insight from, like, looking stuff up and researching things and just... dumb things we've noticed about one of the best worst Christmas movies of all time.
I just saw White Christmas recently for the first time, so I check this out.
Never seen
it. It's so good.
And also, it really hopefully should be up now, our really fun article of the best episodes of the year.
Yep.
Which it was very fun to watch my co-host wince about how they haven't written it yet.
Whoops.
Yeah. That's probably up by now. So find out what dozens of people thought were the best episode TV of the year, and see some cool perspectives.
Yep. Cool.
But thank you all for listening throughout the whole year, throughout the whole show. This is the first episode. Thank you for making it through this. We'll be back next week with episode 104 in 2018. The year that will probably be better than 2017, right?
Hopefully.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
We definitely didn't say that last year at this time. I'm Austin.
I'm Sarah.
I'm Lee.
And I'm Pedro.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye-bye.